So yeah, Matt is gonna join us for this app. He's a friend of mine. He wants to do
a lot of insight.
Should I tell him what you're
doing? So that's
He works in finance, so we thought we'd bring him on for this app, and who knows, maybe you'll hear more of him.
No.
What the hell is that?
This is
I don't know. I'm doing a bad.
Matt, you're really selling it.
Sorry, Matt.
I appreciate that. No, it's fine. Let's go.
We thought instead of growing an audience, we'd just keep adding people to the podcast. That's the way to do it.
That's
I don't want an audience.
Funny, dude.
That's true.
I don't want anyone to hear this.
Get to have a little more fun.
I also don't, you know, too. Please do not put my last name on anything.
Okay.
Thank you.
Spell it in like an offensive ethnic way.
Ooh.
Okay. Nobody else can search you. I don't know what that would be.
I'm into that.
Yeah, I don't know Italian?
You're Italian?
You'll
hey, Adam,
know.
Shut up.
Okay.
Yeah. Also true.
Let's just...
Go. Just go then.
Let's just get started. So today's movie is Bad Influence. It's from 1990. It's directed by Curtis Hanson. It's written by David Koepp. Stars Rob Lowe and James Spader.
Uh-huh.
And this is a movie I saw at New Beverly like 2 or 3 years ago, but I used to watch it on TV in high school. And I always liked these kind of movies where it's like the milquetoast guy and then the creepy sociopath guy who becomes his best friend. And then, but what's interesting watching this now is how similar it is to Fight Club and the Cable Guy.
It's like PG Fight Club.
Cable Guy. I did not think of that, but that's true. Cable Guy is one of these movies.
Yes.
Which came first? Fight Club, the book?
The other thing is, this is influenced by Strangers on a Train, which is originally a novel. And I'm sure there's other thrillers and...
You could go back to like hieroglyphs where there's a guy being like, come on, do it.
Like, throw mama from a train is another one.
Cave art.
Did you guys get any feeling when you're watching this, like during any scene, that like it was almost like a fairy godmother or like a genie-esque? Because they have this one scene where like the dialogue is crazy because he says, yeah, do it. And it's almost like the James Spader guy has to repeat what the other guy is saying, and then it fucking happens.
It's like a devil on his shoulder sort of thing.
I got more homoerotic vibes.
Oh, definitely.
That's where
I was 100% aroused.
That's called the Rob Lowe effect.
Okay,
I would
like,
sure.
What?
Yeah.
Why would I fuck this guy?
Let's set it up very quickly. So James Spader is like, you know, he's a bitch. He's a pussy. He's a nerd, which is interesting because he can play both. He can play the cool guy and he can play the nerd guy.
Yeah, he's like a good actor.
Yeah.
And
it's like, well, how Rob do you Lowe, do that? What's the deal?
I can't imagine Rob Lowe is a nerd at all. He's too handsome. He's always going to be
Cool guy. I've actually heard from, and I don't remember who it was, but somebody at like a comedy show I was talking to, they were like, they're like a third cousin or something of Rob Lowe, and they still see him at like family functions. And they were like, yeah, now he's just like Rob Lowe. Like, he's not even a real person. Like, he just shows up and he's like super pleasant and nice, but it's just all surface.
And well, what's
a third cousin?
He also, apparently he also doesn't believe the Holocaust happened.
No way. I don't believe that. Oh, I think that's a joke. I think that's what's happening. Because we're going to start a rumor now.
You think it's a joke that Rob Lowe is a Holocaust denier?
Yeah.
I always knew that.
Yeah, there's nothing funny about that.
Chris. That's why I got into Parks and Rec. Yeah, I knew about it before.
Oh, yeah. Look, I got to see this Holocaust denial show, Parks and Rec.
Wasn't he kind of like a geek in Parks and Rec? Like, not 100% because he's so good looking.
Like a fitness weirdo. But
he was definitely a weirdo. Like, he's definitely like on
the. That's
the
problem
like,
with Parks and Rec, I think, is like it makes all these, it smooths all these edges and just, I mean, I guess that's what the, it's almost like the joke of the show, but it's like it smooths the edges into just like a likable version.
All right. So
it.
Back to the synopsis.
Yeah.
So James Spader is at work. there's this guy Patterson who it's pretty clear he's like fucking with James Spader. He's deleted his computer file of all the basically like 6 months of transactions or some shit. And so James Spader is too afraid to really confront
him.
Was
he fucking with him or was it embezzling? They were embezzling money.
No, he's so they're both going after the same job promotion.
It's like a very alpha situation. Yeah. These offices, right, Matt?
Yeah. The weird thing about that though is it's like who the fuck, like if you did that in any like you would just like get fired. Like even back in those days, back before
I feel like all four of them would get fired.
Yeah.
Because he's like the only people that had access to this account was you, me, da da da, and da da da. And it's like, well then obviously all four of those people are getting fired.
Yeah, because like honestly, that would probably happen because it's like, A, you're the idiot who like didn't have anything to watch over it. And then the guy who like deletes it and is just like, oh, tough shit. Now you can't get the promotion. Like, none of it made sense. I mean,
look, that's how you get ahead, also- Matt. You know,
and
are you senior? Are you a senior analyst?
Yeah, bro.
That was the other thing.
He is, bro. He's going into work with a rat tail. You don't
he think
he's earned that privilege, bro. He's CEO.
All the bosses have rat
tails. So here's what's weird about that too. I like that kind of like irked me the title that he kept going after. I'm like senior analyst. Like the guy's like almost 30. What the fuck's he doing being an analyst? Like that's like some low ass shit. Yeah, like that's like
dang,
nothing.
Dude, I don't even have a job.
See, here's the thing with
32.
Screenwriters, they're losers, so all their friends are losers. So they learn, they're like, teach me about finance, and his buddy's like 22 or 23. He's like,
exactly,
senior analyst. That's a tough, that's a big job, you know?
Yeah, it sounds right.
Yeah.
So that's why
it's like, oh, that's your next step. Cool. Yeah. So it was just like, it was weird. Also, too, it was strange, like, not to get like too into the weeds because I don't think that's like what's really important about the movie, but it was like strange that the analyst was the one like transacting the business of any kind. It's like, no, that doesn't happen on the street. Like you're an analyst. Like you wouldn't
well,
be
they're
the
working. They
want to
be
on.
Senior analysts. Right.
But even like, like ooh, anyone with so an sweet. Analyst title, it's like, you're ooh. Just a guy that does homework for a living. You
right.
know, like you're just right like path. You research shit.
Is this the same thing that you do, Matt, by the way? Sounds like this is like the same thing.
Mm-mm.
I thought it was similar, but I didn't know if it was like
he's
not
a
really.
Junior. He's a junior analyst.
Yeah.
No,
he's a freshman. The only person we know that works in an office environment. So we're like, yeah, this is what you do, right?
So, yeah, he's just the person who works at an office.
Hold on.
No, I let's run just a get... trade desk for mortgage-backed securities trading. That's what I do.
But he's the one that caused the Big Short.
Mm-hmm.
So that's why we wanted to have him on.
We wouldn't have
so anyway, James Spader is he's butthurt. Okay, so he goes out drinking. He goes all the way to Venice Beach, I guess.
Oh, he obviously
or
has a drinking
Manhattan
problem.
Manhattan Beach.
He yeah, where Manhattan does he? Beach. What's that about?
Wait, he's all over the place.
So he's
movie.
Working at this is now. You want to get inside? He's working on Wilshire by the La Brea Tar Pits, and then goes
right
drinking in Manhattan Beach. Which I
was
guess
it Manhattan
like,
Beach or was it like Venice?
Because he says that's where I met him earlier or later in the movie. So he's at a bar. Yeah. He sees a pretty girl come in. Although it's already established he's engaged to Marsha Cross from Desperate Housewives. But
yeah, but he
that.
Doesn't seem into it at all.
No. So he sees this pretty girl
she
come
she
in.
Sucks.
She can't
well,
find
she had
a wallet.
She had a 2 year plan. First year, get married. Second year, have a kid.
They don't even
and
live
she's
together.
Like, yeah, they don't live together.
But wait, this was 19, what? 89, 90. Yeah, like when they made it. During that time, would they have lived together before getting married? Or is that like... they
in
would?
LA,
so,
yes.
That's not
in
like
LA,
a focus.
Yes.
Okay. Just double checking. I don't know.
Even like weird rich, like it looks like her dad, like whatever that party is. It looks like they're like weird old money Pasadena people. Like
that's true,
but I think even those people, like, they're a little
California
along.
People.
Yeah, exactly.
So it's probably like, cool. Okay.
Of just, course, they're chill.
I mean, they're still like status chasing, obviously, and they're like weirdos, but they're still.
They're still California chiller people than East Coast people.
Here's the thing:
we're not talking.
Definitely, he should not be hitting on other women, though. So he's at the bar, and he offers to buy this woman a drink. He's trying to get in with her.
He does buy her a drink.
But was he like, Lydia wasn't paying attention?
She didn't have money.
She didn't have money. Like, that's the thing. Like, would you do that if you had filthy amounts of money and like this woman can't find her drink and be like, here?
Yeah, I'd be like, but you have to touch my butt.
I don't think I would, but I'm an incel, so like it's that's different for me.
Yeah. Oh, totally. There's a whole different protocol for the incel.
Yeah.
I did the incel thing for like 6 weeks, and it just wasn't for
you
me.
You didn't like it?
No, I liked it. It was great, but I kept having sex, and like I couldn't. couldn't get approved for a gun.
Oh yeah, because you're in Texas now, right?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, that's like the one thing that they do to stop, like that's like the one gun control measure, right? Is it's like, are you fucking? And if you're not, then like, nah, bro.
Yeah.
And I was like, well, how? Like how?
Well, you're in San Francisco.
Have I had to have fucked?
You can't get a gun unless you have gay sex.
You can get it. That's the San Francisco you grew up in. Now you're allowed to get guns if you buy them with Bitcoin.
The sex is encouraged. The sex is encouraged as like a gratuity.
The Bitcoin Pride Parade is just a bunch of incels going down the street.
Yeah, see, that's the thing is
just
like
their asses out and shit.
Yeah, like I
they're still like naked dancing.
To be fair, I partly went incel because A, I got really into cryptocurrency, but also just because that's kind of culturally what's like acceptable now in San Francisco with like the new tech.
You got into it? You're into it?
Yeah, I mean, how could I? I mean, as into it as you can get. I mean, anyway.
Dude, this rat tail has changed you, bro. This rat tail has changed you, bro.
Shut the fuck up, Adam.
Sorry.
I'm muting everyone because this is chaos. This is the worst episode ever.
Will you shut up?
Right.
What were we thinking, having five people? All right, guys. Just kidding.
James Spader's at the bar. He's hitting on this chick. Her boyfriend comes in. James Spader talks back to him. He gets his head in a headlock, his head smashed down the bar. And then Rob Lowe shows up, saves the day. He breaks a beer bottle, threatens to stab this guy. Now, we can talk about Bitcoin. We can talk about where everyone's from. We can make all sorts of stupid jokes. We just got to keep it connected to the movie somehow. That's the challenge.
Mm-hmm. Agree or disagree?
Up, oh, you're muted, Matt.
Oh yeah, Matt, you've been talking.
You have to unmute yourself.
Chris is muted.
All right, so in this scene was muted for this. When he breaks the bottle. This is the scene where we're supposed to be like, Rob Lowe's a badass,
and he is.
Is he?
Hell yeah.
Here's the thing, though.
He's a badass. He's crazy. He's so crazy that this guy's like, I don't want to get stabbed by a beer bottle.
Yeah, and then he's like, I don't think you'll do it. And this is one of the most badass lines in the movie.
He's like, well, let's find out.
Was that your Rob Lowe impression?
I still think it was a setup. Like, I think it was like a scam.
No.
And I can't like decide.
Oh, I see.
Like Rob Lowe was doing the scam?
Yeah. Like he used like the couple, you know, the girl missing the money and then like the guy, like, it all just seemed like, I think that was the thing about the movie, like certain parts about like that, like drove the plot where it's just like, it seemed like a little too cleverly drawn, like jawboned in.
I think it's a coincidence. See,
it is a coincidence. I think it's just poor writing. I think
in Fight Club, it turned out to be like Tyler Durden says, I blew up your apartment, you know?
Yeah.
So like, 10 years later, screenplays would like overcomplicate things to the point where
Fight Club. It works in Fight Club, though.
Shut up, Adam. I know it works. I'm just saying it's more complicated.
The fact that it's like the same person, split personality.
Hey, William, go on.
Spoiler alert.
No, but it works.
I'm just pointing that out.
I never said it didn't work.
Bad. You're acting like this is a bad thing.
You know what's bad is you sitting in the bathroom with that damn banana peel hanging over your sink.
God, you are in the bathroom. I had you far away.
He's eating a banana in the bathroom.
He looks like a Charles Bukowski character who's addicted to eating bananas. Now he's putting his banana all over his laptop.
I love bananas. No.
How are you the only person here who's procreated? Like, why are you a father?
That we know of.
Yeah, I mean, that's the...
That's true.
That's the problem with this world.
Right, boys?
Why was I muted for so long? Fuck you guys.
You have to unmute yourself.
Oh, I didn't
okay,
know
so basically the movie is this. It's like Rob Lowe is teaching James Spader how to be a man. He teaches him how to get revenge on the boss. He teaches him how to bang chicks. Lisa Zane.
Not like that maybe. Bang chicks, but like get chicks to bang. Right?
Yeah, and he kind of, everything's going good until difference? It goes bad. And then James Spader realizes Rob Lowe is a sociopath murdering psycho. So
then he can't get him out of his life.
Here's the thing. What, why is Rob Lowe doing this?
Yeah, that's my question.
Because he's crazy, dude. He's literally like a serial killer.
But it's a lot of work doing all this stuff, setting things up. And then he has to wait hours at moments and just casually be sitting there.
Yeah,
smiling,
yeah. And then he gets a little wave and then has to run away and shit. Like when something passes in front of him. I agree. It makes no sense why he's. And what is that bag at the beginning, by the way? The duffel bag that he throws away.
So in the beginning of the movie, Rob Lowe is in North Carolina, and it's like he's pulling off finishing up a scam. He's having sex with this woman. He gets a duffel bag, fills it with a bunch of stuff, like photos of himself. Basically, I'm assuming evidence of him being there, evidence of his identity. And then as he leaves, he chucks it into a dumpster, like hiding the evidence. And then I guess that this is what he does. He goes from town to town grifting.
I figured that was sort of like what the driving like motivation was for him, right? Was that basically it's like, I mean, obviously he's a psycho, but like, it's just, he's just like a jobless, you know, drifter fuck. Yeah.
Yeah.
Exactly.
He becomes
like, he needs to make money somehow. So he like preys on,
but it's so elaborate,
but he's not exactly motivated by money.
He's like
James Spader, like embezzle, you know, 200 grand and give it to me. And I'll leave forever. Right.
Yeah. Like pull a gun.
No, he took all his furniture and dishes
and then he puts it back. And then he's like,
he didn't put it back. He brought a TV and a VHS back,
but he's like, just because
he took
all the furniture. He
knows technology.
The TV on the floor. That's crazy.
But he's like going through all this trouble just to be this guy's like personal joker.
Take a breath, Chris. Breathe.
I gotta breathe. Guys, this is the thing that bothered me the most and just told me how fucking crazy he was. He is so confident in himself that he's putting himself in these scenarios where he is deliberately lying to people about who he is, his name, but not only that, where he is and like where he's from, to the point where he's putting on a fucking Parisian French accent. He's putting it on all these accents.
The Parisian French accent was awesome.
Okay. Here's the thing.
It was
fucking
terrible.
He's doing this at these high class places. There could very likely be a French person there and start talking to him in French. And he doesn't give a fuck.
No.
And he's just like, keeps going on with it. It's like, dude,
yeah,
he could
awesome.
Be called out so easily.
I'm sorry, it's called white privilege. White male privilege.
Handsome privilege.
Handsome white male privilege.
Yeah. Fake a French accent at a party and get
it's
away
with
like
it. More like a handsome guy, because everybody there was white. So like when everybody true. There is white, like
and they
white,
it was like a privileged event, yeah.
Yeah, like yeah. That blew my mind. I was like, this guy's out of his fucking mind. That was the craziest thing. Not
okay,
that he
so,
murdered somebody.
Yeah, he didn't need
I
to
think
do
it's,
this.
To
actually.
Be fair, I think it's like, I think that's something where like, there's probably a difference between like the 90s and like late 80s or whatever versus like now with like internet stuff where it's like so much stuff is more ubiquitous. Mm-hmm. It's like you can kind of just like lie and be like anonymous, and nobody, it would take people like a while to figure
yeah.
out.
Yeah.
You know,
at least pass the interaction. Like they'd have to go home and figure it out.
It's true. Yeah. That is a real,
also,
like,
you could just
pleasure.
Be like, if somebody calls you out for a fake accent or a bad accent, you just be like, all right, you got me. So I've been taking this like acting class, and this has been a homework.
That probably could have worked.
That's good, Ryan. That's really
good.
Well,
also,
or you just run.
He plays it off like he's charming enough that Lisa Zane character, like, he just drops the accent. She's like, oh, you don't have your accent anymore. But she doesn't mind because she thinks it's like, he's still the most interesting guy at the gallery that she met that night. He's still the funnest guy, the most handsome guy. He's still a cool dude. And it's just like, a lot of those other people were boring. Mm-hmm. I guess here's the thing about narcissists.
Can you hear me?
You could say he's. Yeah.
Yeah. Yes. Unfortunately,
we're just ignoring you. Hear you.
We're just ignoring you. Okay.
Yeah.
So here's the thing. He's a narcissist. He wants attention. He's getting attention. He wants people to pay attention to him. He's getting all that. So
I just don't
understand what he's doing with James Spader. Like, is he? It's like, look, I've been known to bully Adam from time to time.
It's like that.
What is your reasoning?
I guess it's like a bug.
That's the thing. I don't really.
It's like a bug, and you're pulling its legs and wings out.
Yeah, I definitely don't get the end game part. Like, I don't see where it's like, even if like it's just driven by like his weird psychopathy to like murder people and be
does he kill anybody? Like, he's a fucking idiot. If he's a con man, he's an idiot. But if he's like a weird joker figure,
he's a very handsome joker figure. He's like a chaos incarnate, whatever.
Like that, there's a part where he's like laughing in a video camera, and it's like, but it's
forever,
like Rob Lowe's handsome face
forever. It, like that clip like, goes on forever.
You're like, I just want to open up.
Let's talk about some of the great scenes in this movie and some of the cool things Rob Lowe does. So the coolest thing he does is secretly records James Spader having sex with Lisa Zane. And then the next day he's just laughing, watching it on video. And I
in
like how Lisa
room.
Zane comes in and she's like, oh, I thought you looked pretty good. You know, Dominique. And she's talking about James Spader, 'cause he's all horrified. But I like that she just
didn't give a shit.
And
because that video is not going to get circulated publicly, you know,
the internet.
Like,
hold on, let's keep going. So later on, there's an engagement party at James Spader's and his fiance's parents' house. There's all these fancy rich people. They're all gathering around, and Rob Lowe shows up and he puts the videotape on in the family room, and everybody gets to watch James Spader have sex with another woman.
And he does this because he knows James Spader isn't in love with it, or isn't down for this marriage. So he's like, I'm helping you.
A scene or two earlier, he asked him, what do you want? And he's like, you want to get married? He's like, no, I don't want to get married. So he's breaking up the marriage.
Done.
I got you, bro.
Here's the big grand irony, and this is honestly why the movie's more famous for anything, which is when they were in pre-production, Rob Lowe had a sex tape circulate where he had sex with a 24-year-old woman and a 16-year-old girl. Okay, so Rob Lowe met these girls at a mall or a bar or something, hooks up with them at a hotel. No. So not only is he not canceled,
it's the 80s.
They kept making the movie. So the girls tried to sell the tape because they stole it. Okay. And they ended up circulating it. And it was one of the first celebrity sex tapes that got passed around.
And I didn't realize that it was during this movie.
So it's very ironic that there are things that people assume that in the screenplay for this movie was written
around
that mind. Yeah. And it was like a meta element to the storytelling. They also, there's like a threesome later on with Rob Lowe And I'm assuming people thought that was like a riff of the reality of the situation.
This was in the news.
Basically, this ruined, that whole thing ruined Rob Lowe's career.
This was on Weekend Update.
Until Tommy Boy.
Until, no.
Yeah.
Wayne's World.
Wayne's World.
Until the 16-year-old girl was of age.
Incredible.
And then Wayne's, but he also said,
she knew how to fuck, and obviously she'd been fucking for years. And everyone's like,
this is, when this happened, it was like, oh, Rob Lowe's the victim. That 16-year-old girl lied to him.
Yeah. I remember that.
That's how those things were treated. Because like Tracy Lords was the same thing.
Yeah, it's like her fault.
I mean,
she lied. It's like, oh, you lied about your age. You're not supposed to do that.
Damn.
When you have sex
back
with a celebrity,
in the good old days,
you can't be ruining this one of the Brat Packers.
How could you do this to Rob Lowe?
Didn't it, wasn't it the thing that spurred Rob Lowe into sobriety?
Yes.
That's what I thought. And he's been like sober ever since, I guess. So, like,
that's crazy because he's always seemed sober. Was he not sober in this movie?
He's no like coke and shit. You know what I mean?
So in San Elmo's like Fire,
he always seems the same.
Also, he was a sex addict.
Is he a good actor?
Yes. No. He is.
Yes.
No.
He is. Yes. Yeah. No. He is.
I don't.
Not in this movie.
He is.
Yeah. He is.
He's great in this movie. Okay. Are you kidding me?
I think Ryan. What do you say that maybe you just think he's like miscast?
He's not a good
bit?
Villain, but I think I think it's because he did do good. He did do very well in this movie. But
you ever see Tommy Boy?
Benjamin in Wayne's World is one of the all time.
But he always kind
of
plays
villains.
Himself.
Yeah, sure.
The movie that really turned me on Rob Lowe was St. Elmo's Fire, where he plays a out of control drug addict party boy saxophone player.
Dude, that sounds
awesome, dude.
Easily gets imaginable. Out of control in sax players.
He's the coolest thing in the movie.
They have so much to leg up for.
Be like, dude, slow down.
Can you imagine a coked out saxophone solo? Oh, man.
I don't fuck with sax players, man. I never have.
That's why people would get into jazz, I think, because they'd be seeing guys on coke just wailing on the sax. And be
no,
like,
heroin.
Just saxing.
People loved heroin when they were jazz. Like, all those dudes, the fucking legends, they all had heroin addictions.
I think you're both right.
Yeah, probably.
Yeah.
I think they do all the drugs in the jazz world. True.
This is true. But hold on, one thing. My favorite part of that scene, speaking of homoerotic things, that scene where he's like eating ice cream in the morning, watching the sex tape that he made of David Spader, is when he's like, you make a funny face when you come, you know, right?
Yeah.
And the way that like comes back like later in the movie is like such a good, just like,
when cum is in it, that's a good that's a good version of that sort of line.
The screen
like,
is well written.
No, you.
Yes.
So what? While we're on this subject, what is everybody? We'll start with Adam. What's your cum face look like?
Oh, whoa. Like that.
Yeah, I guess you'll have to do it as like a onomatopoeia for the listeners.
Oh, what? What's an what are you saying? An
onomatopoeia? The noise. Do it as a noise. Do your climax.
He did.
I just did that.
That's it. That's fine. Not it, dude.
Maybe somebody else should. Like maybe you should go, climax. Motherfucker.
I'll go. Mine is
motherfucker.
Ouch! Oh, what are you doing to me? And that's just the pre-cum.
Imagine
if the
sex tape that
fell
past me getting warmed up, baby.
Damn.
Ouch. Imagine if the sex tape the whole family's watching and it's just Ryan getting bent over.
I'm getting pegged.
Well, not even pegged. The woman's just like, I don't know.
What are you doing to me?
Jerking you off. You're like, ouch.
No, don't stop. Ouch, though. Ow, whoa.
Yeah, that'd be embarrassing.
I also like how I've seen them, like, Marsha Cross is trying to fast forward. I turned the tape off, but she fast forwards. So then they start having sex faster in the video.
Yeah,
yes,
I gotta say, you just see them in a bunch of different positions, like in 2 seconds.
What a, What a stupid Luddite. Like, it's a good thing that he fucking failed on that marriage.
Yeah, totally.
Like, learn to use a fucking VCR.
Yeah, it's 1990. You can't use a VCR.
Yeah.
I want to say, when I did see that scene, there was part of me that was kind of like, you know what? There's no way James Spader's character would have fucking, like, broke up with this girl. He would have been, I was like, maybe this dude did do him a solid. Maybe this is the best thing that's gonna happen.
That's what he thinks too.
And then but
he's mortified at first. Yeah. But he gets over it very fast. Yes.
He gets over it real fast and gets fucked up and goes and has fun.
But like, they make it in such an easy break. Like, it's not someone he works with. It's like she's probably someone who's very intertwined with him in his social life and his family circle or whatever. Like, they just make it like, oh yeah, this one random girl is gone and now he can move on. But
right.
These kind of guys, it's always like a college sweetheart or some shit or like
simps.
Yeah, they strike me as like him.
That's what that is. That's what that means.
I know. It's just funny hearing it from you. I don't know.
It's not?
No.
What is it?
I think it's weird.
A simp is a guy who is like worships like any girl that he doesn't give a shit about him.
Gotcha.
It's not like what is that college guy? Sweethearts.
Who's the college sweetheart guy? What's his name?
His name is Adam.
I wish, man.
And her name is Melanie.
No, that sounds weird. I wish I would have been with my wife since college, is what I said.
Okay.
We get it. I wish
we were in college, you were with Whitney so that I did not have to deal with all of your mishaps.
Yeah.
Did you know he drank piss?
That's true.
I know everything. I got fun stories that I'm not going to share about young Adam Bowers on a recorded line.
Another thing I like about the movie. So James Spader has a brother named Prismo.
I like this.
Who's a loser.
Yeah. I love the brother.
I like him too. But here's the thing I like about it is that there's always, in every relationship, someone is the James Spader and someone's the Rob Lowe. And that normally James Spader is getting kicked on, but when he's around Prismo, he's like the cool guy, the successful guy, the guy who's got together, the guy who gives advice. And I don't really recognize his actor. I feel like I've seen him in a bunch of stuff, but he really looks like he looks like if you put James Spader in a microwave.
Yeah. He really was like
a skinny Philip Seymour Hoffman.
Yeah, that's a good way to do it.
He has like a bowl haircut.
He looks like
Philip Seymour Hoffman.
Yeah, I mean, he was like the ultimate like
soggy James Spader.
Soggy James Spader. You know what I liked about this movie, going back to what we were talking about as far as the script being well written? I loved how the brother had that like marijuana charge and it kind of like ruined his life. Because at first it was like, well, what the fuck? Because then at the end, when we just know that his brother has experienced what it's like to be, you know, to have a charge. And when that chick's killed, it's like, you don't need to say anything. There's just automatically, there's a heightenedness to their relationship all of the sudden that I thought was really cool. I don't know if that makes sense, but like just him knowing that he's had legal problems and now this is happening, you don't need to say anything. It's like, oh God, everything's fucked. Not like it wouldn't be if they didn't have that, but for some reason that just put on an extra level of, I have to help my brother out.
I liked the part where he, like, they're like working together and stuff, and like we follow him as he does this like spy thing.
Yeah, that was
the spy thing.
Oh, that was cool.
That was awesome.
That like the whole detective act.
Yeah.
He should be the new Batman.
He's a unique movie stoner. This character, I think.
Yes.
Very few movie stoners are like this.
Honestly a classic form of movie stoner. So there's like the Cheech and Chong type, but there's also the successful like college guy smokes weed, like the Donald Sutherland and
but he's not successful. He's
the
he should have been successful,
but he got
weed is like
right.
He's like a depressing stoner. You don't see a lot of depressing stoners in movies.
You're talking to one right now, dude.
Fun and stuff. There's no place in.
And the in the 90s, cocaine was cool and weed was for losers.
Yeah.
In West LA, anyway.
Yeah.
And this movie is very West LA. And another thing I like about it are some of the cool bands and nightclubs they go to, which is like a staple of like a thriller. So the first nightclub they go to has this band called the Nymphs playing. And they just look like the most, like the shittiest alternative rock band.
Okay, right.
Like a four non-blondes type hat.
It was like pre-Burning Man. Like,
yes.
This is like the type of people that would be at Edwardian balls now.
Yes, Edwardian balls. I'll say they
Edwards balls. Who's that?
They fucking nailed the LA vibe of going to a bar like that's kind of weird and too cool. Like, and even that band, like I loved the music, hearing it in the background. I was like, it felt like everything I experienced like when I first came to LA and like, I don't know, around 2006 to 2010, like that whole area, all of my first experiences of going into like an LA bar or an LA this, it was that exact vibe, but just because however many years earlier, it was perfect.
Because those people never left.
And right.
They're still playing those shows.
It's
That's who plays LA bars.
That's the cool thing about LA bars. Yeah.
That type of person will always be in LA. And we'll always be making that shit like that. The thing with the mystery solving thing with the lights dance and the dancing and the fucking weird bar.
The second bar.
Yeah, I've been to that bar.
Yeah.
You know.
Yeah.
When you first moved to LA, like S&M, like whatever performance art bullshit.
Like, here's the thing: dancing with S&M.
Is that the one where they went and made out in the bushes?
No. So that's. That's like an underground hipster party thing. So when you first move to LA, you just say yes to everything. You just go out with these random people. You're like, sure, I'll hang out with this person. And you end up in like
the craziest situation.
The craziest situations, the dumbest situations, the lamest situations. Like you'll just hang out with strangers and then, you know, you'll get the fear at like 1 a.m. and just like go home by yourself. And
James Spader,
they'll abandon you or you'll abandon them or whatever.
Yeah, this is also kind of like Crash, where it's like James Spader entering this bizarre, edgy world.
This underworld.
Yeah, underworld or whatever. But this one is like weird LA Hollywood and shit.
It's weird that he doesn't like, he has no conception of it though. Like that it's so new to him, because it strikes me that he's like, the impression I get, because I mean, we don't get much of a backstory on him, but it's like he clearly probably is like a West LA, like born and raised, like rich kid, you know, like I would think, I mean, like, and it seems like his social circle is entirely like of the same. Like, when you think of like college sweetheart for the girl, like, I honestly think like he's like, they like knew each other in high school or some shit, you know, like they probably went to like fucking, I don't know, some like weird private school that I don't know the fucking name of in like Brentwood or some shit, you know, like
Buckley.
So it's like strange to me that he's like, that it's all completely new to him.
He's supposed to be like 29.
I don't think he is a rich kid.
Is he 28?
Something like that.
I think he's 29. He's like just under 30.
They do mention he's just under 30. So
I think he's just a straight laced dude. I think he may know of it, but he's just like a straight laced dude who maybe his parents were overbearing and were just like, look, you need to be successful. This is the most important thing. So you just ignore all that. And
nerdy.
Like,
he's a nerdy guy.
Get a dumbass apartment or house. His house was so stupid.
That loft is awesome, dude.
I thought it was great.
Dude, fucking, it looks so. It looks so stupid.
It's such a good like
story glass. Has 2-story glass bricks.
Yeah.
That was tight, but like the way he laid out the furniture and stuff, it's not how I would have decorated it.
Okay,
that shit was stupid.
Well, that's okay, Ryan. That's that's part of his character, though. He's not,
so here's the thing. I wouldn't know. You listen, Willie. No, you listen, Willie. I
stop.
I would have decorated it how in the second or probably the third act, how we had it decorated in the third act. You just okay. need a TV, a camera. That's it.
Yeah.
Okay. All right.
TV stand. No. So
you don't like the furniture. You don't like the.
I thought it looked better when Rob Lowe took all the silverware and all the furniture and all the plateware utensils.
And had the dead woman
all that.
In the back. You like the dead yeah.
See,
woman
that's
head.
How I would have started the deck. Like.
I get it.
If you're not accenting your apartment with a dead woman.
So at the beginning of the movie,
what are you doing?
When you first see his apartment, he's showing his brother sees the video camera. You see the golf clubs in the corner of the room and there's really nothing else. So you just know like, okay, something's going to get videotaped and someone's going to get killed with golf clubs.
Also, I love that he had a Diners Club.
It's
card.
Like an Adam's bathroom right now. Like, mm-hmm. I see Adam.
That was such a sick line where he's like, and your Diners card probably.
He gets the Diners card in the beginning too.
Yeah, well, because isn't it like the replaced one or whatever? Like, because doesn't he get it in the beginning, like right after he loses the wallet, like they send him a new one or something?
Something like that. Yeah. I remember he put it in.
He doesn't have
like,
money later. He doesn't have money at the bar.
No, he had money at the bar.
No, he didn't. He didn't have his wallet. Yeah. He's like, I don't have my wallet.
Yeah. That bar. Yeah. What, by the way, isn't that chick who was like the punk rock chick who wasn't the one that ended up being in the fucking thing, didn't she become an actress
she was like redheaded or something,
yeah, something like that.
Marsha Cross,
was that who
from
was?
Desperate Housewives?
No,
that's his wife or fiance,
the other one, the one that
Zane? At the bar that was like didn't
the one
seem
the
interested
bar with the, spikes.
The one that he went up and bought a drink for.
Mm-hmm. No, he bought a drink for the other girl.
I don't know.
And this was this girl's friend.
Both. Anyway, who cares?
Okay. Yeah, you're right.
I think that became Meryl Streep.
Oh, yeah. That was
that really
was
role
her
for her.
Yeah.
Exactly. That after Dear Hunter.
She did all right.
I wish I was at one of those parties right now.
A Hollywood party. Here.
Yeah, instead, Adam, you're just leaning back next to a bathroom sink.
So I wish I was at a Hollywood.
So
party.
I remember one time in San Francisco, I went to an underground show, mm-hmm. and I did coke in the bathroom with this one woman who was like 10 years older than me or 15 years older than
oh
me.
Oh my God, I'm so glad. I'm so glad you said it.
Oh man.
Not younger.
The way you said that was like, Jesus.
But here's what's funny.
What?
A 10-year-old.
She,
this was my Rob Lowe moment.
She told me about like growing up in Seattle and like liking grunge music. And she's like, yeah, you know, this is what we liked and blah, blah, blah. And I didn't make out with her or anything. Because I was a fucking loser, like but
coward.
God damn it!
So I think she added me on MySpace. We added each other on MySpace or something.
Damn,
and then the
so
next day,
like
that's
cool.
I realized
that's kind of like making out.
The next morning, I went to check on it, and she deleted me as a friend.
Yeah.
Oh, you guys added each other in face to face or whatever.
Well, I didn't even have a smartphone. She had like a sidekick or something.
Sidekicks, remember those?
Hell yeah.
Oh man, I'm so jealous of people that sidekick.
I wish, man, Willie, I wish it was that easy still, just to delete friends.
The problem, man, is you should have put a ring on it that night, not fucking tried to make out with her. Like this.
I thought she was annoying, but she was the only person who talked to me. So
she was on cut.
What does that say about you?
Wait, where was the underground party in SF? Like what neighborhood? It was
insane. Well, it was Mission Bay before it was built up. It was a little insane.
Oh, shit. Really? Okay. Nice.
Yeah, you guys.
Sad base.
It's right by the San Francisco. Where you get on the Bay Bridge south of Market.
William's a Bay boy.
More like a beta boy. Are you kidding me? Oh, like a beta. This dude did. No, this dude didn't even make out with this cokehead.
That's true.
And she was old too, so you knew she was like, hey man, I got this cute little white boy right up in here that I'm giving drugs to, and
oh,
dude, you fucked up, Willie.
I want to feel relevant.
just the fact that he did drugs with her makes me think like that's a pretty big step.
I just wanted the drugs
at this point. Did you do drugs before that? Because it sounds like you didn't do drugs before that. Because nobody else would talk to you. No, it's like this sounds like your first cocaine experience.
She was probably like, you want to make out? And you were like, you know what that reminds me of is my favorite makeout scene in this movie that was filmed at this and that and that and this.
And she's like, why don't you move to LA?
You do that.
She's like, Willie.
And now I'm here.
Yeah. And then I took over Will's spot here in San Francisco. Now I live in Selma.
Now you're a bay boy.
Mm-hmm.
That's cool.
I'm the bay boy now.
Cool.
Fuckers.
Little rat tail BB.
Yeah.
That's right. That's right, baby.
I love the
bay boy.
RTBB. Little rat tail BB. Rat tail bay boy.
What if RTBB got a rat tail? That'd be sick, dude.
RTBB.
His whistles would be a lot chiller. His whistles would be like.
He's just like a big can of PBR.
He's like, chill.
Yo, dude, white trash Star Wars. Write it up, guys.
All right, let's get Seth MacFarlane on the phone. He's doing too many Star Wars reenactments.
Seth Greed?
I'm talking about Family Guy.
Oh, Family. What did they do? Like three of them?
Seth, is that Seth MacFarlane?
Yeah, well, who cares?
Exactly.
That reminds me of Bad Influence. The movie Bad Influence.
So what reminds you of it? To? the TV stand.
Is there a TV stand in Family Guy?
Adam,
probably.
I related to the fiance for how wrong she was. I feel like I'm very wronged a lot.
Oh, how wrong.
Oh, my God. Your girlfriend, you got a victim.
Your fiance fucked another guy in video in front of you?
No, not the specific.
Dude, I swear to God.
You're a cuck?
I swear to God, at some point, Rob Lowe's character was going to have fucked the fiance. I was waiting for that.
It's a possible screenplay. That's obvious.
Yeah, I guess not. I was like, and they were going to, like, I don't know, throw it back in Spader's face somehow, like either videotape it or just like whatever.
That would have made James Spader mad, though.
I don't know. I think it still would have made him like.
And then his fiance is crazier than Rob Lowe. So then now Rob Lowe has like his own stalker and it's it. It's just whole.
Yeah. And she kills somebody at his wherever he's staying.
He's getting most of his ideas from her.
Okay, what did you guys think of the night they go out to like this old mansion and then they get extremely drunk and they decide to just commit armed robbery for fun?
Well, that was tight, dude. And that was tight because he wore that bunny mask. He was such a good henchman.
Yeah.
Yeah, he was like
the things
like
he could do in the
90s.
He was wasted. He was like falling asleep in the car. He was blacked out. He doesn't even remember it.
Every good stick up needs a guy with the gun who's like intimidating, and then a guy who, like behind him who's wearing a
wild
mask
card
and being weird and shit. It's like doing weird shit behind him.
Well, then A plus in this movie.
I like that he gets in. I like that James Spader gets into it, and then they rob a donut shop because they want to get donuts.
Yeah.
Yeah, I like that too.
Yeah, that was neat. And it's like, how come we can't do that? Like, what's happened to our friendship?
Too many everybody's got video cameras now and video on their phone.
I've got a bunny mask.
Yeah, but you could still...
Also, thanks for seriously answering that question.
That's why we could.
Hey, how come we don't do that? How come we don't rob donut stores at gunpoint anymore?
We would get caught way more easily. You know what? There's this little scene. There's this little scene I love when he says, "Hey, you got to pull over," and he gets out, and you think he's gonna throw up, but he doesn't throw up. He's just kind of like
he was nauseous.
He was nauseous, but like he kind of composed himself, and then he was like, "All right, let's go."
Let's hit another one.
Like there was something about that just felt very real. Like that, like you think he's gonna throw up and be sick, but no, he's just like, "Let's go." And
he thought he was too, though. He thought he was gonna throw up too because that was his first like
Well, here's the thing. At the beginning of the movie, when he's in the bar talking to the couple, he tells her, like, when I was a kid, I would go to Disneyland and I would be on the Pirates of the Caribbean ride, and I wished I could just live with the pirates and escape.
Those robot pirates?
Oh, yeah.
And that kind of sets up his whole inner motivation for wanting to be like a criminal and be a tough guy. But I thought it was very funny.
He just wanted to move to Tampa, Florida.
Yeah, I thought
that'd be cool.
And live with a bunch of robot skeletons.
You should have just done that instead of all the.
I mean, that's where you find the pirates.
Yeah.
Well, you also don't need to rob like a hamburger stand in a donut shop when you are just trading millions of dollars on a daily basis.
Yeah, but if you're hungry, bro.
It's about the,
he didn't. He didn't have his wallet. It's like he didn't even watch the same movie, William. He didn't have his wallet. He's not going to pay for it. He couldn't pay for it if he wanted to. So he put on a bunny.
Honestly, I wouldn't pay. That didn't look like a very appetizing burger. I got to be honest.
Damn.
Like, oh, it looked like shit.
More San Francisco snobbery. From Matt.
You're just sitting on a toilet. That's your home office. Oh,
you're a snob too, William? You're being a snob? Whatever, guys.
You're in the shitter.
This is literally how you hide away from your child. Sitting in the shitter. Are you back home in Laguna Hills or wherever the fuck you live now?
I live in Laguna Beach, bitch. I'm a fucking poser.
That's not cool. Shut up. That's not cool.
That's not cool at all. You could be living in LA, going to fucking quasi S&M parties, fucking hanging with Rob Lowe, having threesomes. The morning of like getting shot by, you know, a commodities trader, or you live in fucking Laguna Hills and pretend like it's Laguna Beach and correct me like you fucking know what you're talking about. But sure, whatever.
And then he complains about like he's up. Like my neighbor's a cop.
Yeah, who cares?
He does.
Yes.
Oh, I mean, this happened like a long time ago, right after I moved. William holds on to.
He said this multiple times. He doesn't remember repeating it.
This was like a year ago, though.
My neighbor's a cop, guys.
That's great. Nobody's going to be robbing your place. You can still smoke weed because it's legal there. What are you doing that like a cop's going to care about you, dude? Trust me.
He doesn't want his son growing up around cops worshiping them.
Lived here for a year now, and I've actually like cops now.
you're a total sellout, bro.
Yeah. I love cops now.
Because you live in Orange County, and that's
I live in the suburbs now. So I've been in the suburbs for a year, and now cops are the best. Come on, guys.
Cops are the best.
It does depend. They are different types of people. I don't know.
A few bad apples.
I used to fucking despise cops of all shapes and sizes, and then eventually you get to know some, and you're like, oh, this guy's not that bad. Like, I don't know.
So they get you.
Oh, see, I feel the exact opposite way because I live in San Francisco.
Oh yeah. Oh yeah. I mean that, and if every you're cop dealing is an with enemy. Those cops. Sure, if you're dealing in that, and you're punk rock Matt, like you can't, you're not allowed. You're not allowed.
Yeah, you're just living the punk rock lifestyle, Matt.
You've got a rat tail, bro. Like you can't, fucking like cops.
Also, bleach tips. Let's be honest.
Yeah, I know.
A lot of problems, problems going on here.
Great.
I mean, it's a great style, but like you know,
thank you.
Yeah, like you know, you have to hate cops. That's a requirement.
Yeah, totally.
I mean, after they didn't do shit about the person that hit and run my fucking truck, like.
But aren't they not? Oh, that's why you hate cops. In San Francisco now, aren't they just not allowed to do anything because, like,
no, that's bullshit. Like, I mean, they. So that's like.
They shake down drug dealers all the time. That's what they do.
Yeah, like
they go to the Tenderloin and they hold kids upside down and pour the crack out of their mouths.
Whoa.
Yeah. The thing that they don't do as much anymore, but they like they make a big deal out of it because they just want to like stick it to Chesa Boudin. But they basically are like, oh, we're not going to bother with like shoplifting stuff, like shoplifting, like you know, shoplifting charges or whatever. And it's like,
yeah,
except for the fact that like that's such bullshit because it's like you never did, like, and we don't but like
Isn't it going like crazy now?
Hold on. I just want everyone to know Adam pulled an apple out of the toilet and now is eating it.
God damn it, Adam.
Oh, Jesus Christ. You are going to get out of the toilet.
Well, a police officer is petting his head, rubbing his large phallus on his ear.
Oh, gross.
There's no police officer. Look, I got this from the kitchen.
San Francisco is a dump. Okay. That's the thing. You know, since 1849, it's been one big shithole.
Okay. I've seen the most human feces on a sidewalk that I have ever seen has been in San Francisco in like a one day period.
Granted, three
of those turds were mine.
Right.
If you're a smart, Matt,
just trying to assimilate, motherfucker.
And it was four. I saw four turds that day.
Honestly, that's a lot. This is probably the most I've ever seen.
And it was four in one day.
Matt, if you're smart, you'd move to South San Francisco, okay? Like all the Italians did.
I do. South San Francisco's definitely its own fucking weird ass shit, man. And yeah, because they all left fucking Castro after.
Dude, if you were smart, you'd move to Pacifica, okay?
Oh Jesus, God no! What are you? You're a monster.
You guys are such bay boys right now.
I don't know what the hell. Yeah, you guys, this is some beta boy shit.
I just want to point out.
Oh yeah,
beta bay boy.
I have seen more human feces on the streets of St. Pete, Florida, than I have in San Francisco. Like people always like.
Oh, you're just talking about the people. The people of Florida are considered all the feces.
I mean, they are. I don't disagree with that, but I'm saying like a lot of like Florida has like really like has like the same bad homeless like situation that we do here.
So you'd compare San Francisco to Florida.
Let me ask you something, Matt.
Yeah.
You ever take the BART train down to Colma?
No, I have. Maybe I have.
What are you guys talking about?
We're getting just being a bay boy. Right? Let's talk about the movie. All right.
What's that?
We got to talk about the movie, guys. We got to wrap this shit up. Okay. So,
yeah.
In the end, James Spader gets his balls. He hunts down Rob Lowe, tricks him, secretly videotapes him confessing to everything, then shoots him when he tries to attack him. And I guess it all worked out, you know? Rob Lowe got killed.
I thought it was
very
weird,
clean.
Though. Yeah, it
very
was
clean
like
ending.
Almost a little too clean. Because I think there was something I remember about the end where he's like confessing everything, but he like perfectly leaves out something where it's just like, yo, Spader was up in that shit too. Like,
hiding the body.
Right.
You're doing armed robbery.
Like, I was thinking about that too.
Like, there's no way he'd be forgetting about that. And like, although,
do you think that you would be absolved, or like, how do you think you would be tried if the exact same thing happened to you and you told the cops everything? And
you're
my brother tried to hide the body.
They have a videotape of Rob Lowe confessing.
I know, but he also hit a body.
Yeah, I think it depends.
Yeah,
just leave that out
of that stuff.
But you're allowed
like in the.
The thing is, in the city of LA, you're allowed to dispose of a body in the La Brea tar pits.
Once a year, you have like a 1 year, or did they? Wasn't there a new voting like Prop 10
on
that?
No, it goes back to
like you can do one and a half
days. You could, the cops were allowed to throw one Mexican into the La Brea tar pit.
I thought it was like six.
No,
they dropped it. These fucking liberals, man. You can only do one, you can only murder one Mexican person and throw them in the La Brea tar pits.
City's changing.
Not murdering
man.
Him, they're just watching him sink.
I'm glad I got out of there, bro.
Yeah, you're so glad you moved to Texas.
Me too, man.
Yeah, oh, like, there's no cap for how many people you can throw on a tar pit. We're just trying to plug up these tar pits.
Yeah.
I've actually never been to the tar pits. Lived in LA for like God knows how long.
Meet Adam's bathroom.
I've turned Adam's bathroom into a tar pit or two.
Yeah, that's true.
I'll tell you that much.
Nice. The tar pits are like kind of cool.
They found the body in that tar pit immediately, right?
Well,
or like
Rob
3
Lowe,
days.
Rob Lowe,
because Rob Lowe called it in, right?
Called it in, followed them, knew the whole thing. And then he was eating popcorn laughing.
Yeah. I like how he was eating popcorn. Anyway.
Yeah.
See, the thing is, to get the popcorn takes so much work.
Yeah.
It's he made the popcorn.
He made the popcorn himself.
Yeah, I was wondering, like, where the fuck did
he runs the popcorn stand on the corner.
At one point in time, popcorn places were very popular around the U.S.
Like hot dog stands.
He didn't microwave popcorn.
I remember my mom telling
me holding a microwave over his shoulder.
You know how like certain things go in and out of fads? Well, like there was a time where like
the popcorn boom of 2000.
It was like it was popular. So maybe he got it from one of those places. Maybe it wasn't as weird as it sounds now. Fuck you, Adam.
You're right.
I think it would have been a lot cooler if he had like what's the mayonnaise corn thing on the stick? Elote?
Cotton candy?
Oh yeah. Or like what about like an elephant ear? Something like that.
An elephant ear would have been sick.
Like a big funnel cake thing from State Fair.
It's the tar pits. Ooh. That's where Mexicans are getting thrown into. Like you would think there'd be churro stands.
That's true.
You know,
there wouldn't be anybody to work the churro stands because they're all getting tossed into the freaking pit.
What if he had a big dildo that he was just sucking on?
He's eating it. He's taking bites out of it.
And he's like, hello.
Hey, hold on. Speaking of Bay Boy shit, there's that fucking amazing
dildo
bakery in the Castro that does like big cock
chocolate
cookies.
Dicks.
God bless you.
Yeah. It would have been cool as fuck if he was like chomping on one of those.
Yeah, totally.
Like, it's just edible panties. I went to San Francisco for the night.
I feel like I brought you back a present. Questions.
Yeah, totally. Oh my god,
it would be cool if he took the Fremont train to the Castro Valley station.
Hey boys.
Or San Leandro.
Take it easy.
I forget my BART routes.
I kind of forget. Yeah, I haven't been on BART in 2 years. Like,
who's BART?
Are bars still open in San Francisco, or like, can you not go in without like?
You have to wear a gas mask.
Yeah.
Yeah, but that's just because it's more. But that's because it's like the bars I go to, because it's all like the weird kink bars.
Right.
That's why. That's what the gas mask's for. Like.
Right.
Because
I'm not in the fucking like tech part.
Just listening to Dracula getting fucked up. The DNA lounge.
Everybody has rat tails.
Just playing with your rat tail. Just stroking
part of Soma. So like it's still all just like leather daddies and like gas masks and like weird chains and you know guys on leashes.
Is Stud still open?
No, Stud closed, man. That was a real bummer. Like I'm not
on Sixth Avenue. Drive south of Market. See Stud,
Stop Street. Doing this.
I used to live off of Sixth and Market, actually.
Adam, where'd you used to live?
Adam's been to that apartment. This is still one of my favorite things about that Adam's ever said. Speaking of being a Bay Boy. When I last lived here like 10 years ago and I lived in the Tenderloin, it was like Geary and Larkin. So it was like closer to like Polk area. And Adam visits me with Whitney. I think you guys had only just started dating I think it was like the first time he even met Whitney.
He's
such a gay
boys. Okay.
What did Adam say? He's like, can I drink this? He's just underneath the homeless guy's
But Adam, no joke, comes to my apartment, which was like this SRO.
I was there with my girlfriend.
Yeah, that became your wife.
Yeah.
This was my first time meeting her. And he literally described the apartment as apparently after the fact, he didn't tell me this. But he's I definitely, like, we walked out, me and Whitney, and I was just like, this seems like an apartment you get to kill yourself in.
Oh, yeah.
Like, and it really was like that depressing. Like, it was a straight up like.
And now Adam is sitting in a bathroom, eating apples out of the toilet.
The toilet's empty.
And he's complaining about my fucking shithole of an apartment.
No, Matt used to live in like a converted hotel room and like the really
shitty part of San Francisco. We know what an
SRL is. Okay, yeah.
It was cool. And,
we know where the tenderloin is. Come on, Adam.
Bay Boys know.
Yeah, all our audience are, most of our audience are Bay Boys too, I guess. Too.
Adam hides fruit around his apartment the way drunks Williams do. Friends.
That I what?
Yeah. Drunks, drunks hide fruit around their apartment?
That's kind of a fun. Yeah, that is actually kind of a drunk move. Except I would think the reason you're hiding fruit around is because you're a diabetic and you just want your sugar fixes. And
yeah.
You don't want Whitney to know.
That you're honestly, if you live with another
trying
person,
to prevent
you should,
that scurvy.
Yeah. If you live with another person, you should hide all their fruit. And then they, you know, if they want the vitamins and stuff, they have to play your little game.
That's a sucky dick.
Your little devilish games.
That doesn't seem reasonable at all. And
I mean, that's why Rob
kind
Lowe
of a Rob
is doing,
it's kind of a Rob Lowe sort of move.
Hiding
sorry,
popcorn
guess.
Around the city. Just waiting yeah. to like trick people. Like
so you can do a little wave and then run away as like a cart passes by.
You know what this is? This is like a one-man version of the game. You know?
Yeah, I thought about the game.
Yeah,
too,
I thought about the game as well. I was like, nice, not as.
I don't know what the game is.
Oh, dude, you haven't seen the game.
Oh, dude, the game.
It's
the
this
game.
Book
talk
right, about how to pick
one
up
of the
women.
Best Bay Boy movies.
Hey, don't hate the player.
The game. The game fucked me up. Like, I think I saw it. I think I was like a young teenager or something. And like,
as opposed to an old teenager,
yeah. Like a 13 year old, as opposed to like a 17 year old. Like, there's a difference there.
Oh, okay.
Like a 13 year old, and it
not
like
to me, buddy.
It kind of. Okay.
Yeah, because they're all illegal. They're not. There's no difference to me either.
Right.
They're all out of bounds.
That's nice. That's a perfect save if you're a pedophile.
That's a perfect
save. And you accidentally let that slip out.
Not to me, buddy.
You accidentally get a little
they're
comfortable.
All but
that
yeah,
is the dude. Go zone. That's a Frisco special. 13-year-old and a 17-year-old.
Yeah, that's a Bay Boy thing.
God, I don't like it when William wears these glasses.
Yeah.
Really like, gets weird when he wears these glasses. Yeah.
His look is complete now. Now it's time to act on your urges.
You know, if they were doing this in San Francisco, the movie would be completely different. It would not be like, especially in 1990, it would not be like fancy nightclubs, fancy bars, sophisticated people. It would just be like gross hippie girls, street people.
In the when?
At the same time,
I agree with that.
1990.
Oh, in San Francisco.
There's never always two halves.
No, there's still a big finance department. And
yeah, this is about yuppies. This is about yuppie culture. 80s yuppie culture.
Let's all try to go with the bit. Let's all pretend it's a comedy show we're doing. Where?
What was the joke? What you were trying to say?
Yeah. Also, what was the bit?
Yeah.
Hippies, bro. Early 90s hippies, just go like granola hippies.
Yeah,
what other kind of hippies?
Yeah,
like if you like murdering a girl with a golf club wouldn't even be illegal if it was like a street person, you know,
now. I think you're allowed to murder street people in San Francisco now.
I mean, I haven't got charged
finally
as long as
that's what happens when the white people move in.
That's part of gentrification.
White people have always been
allowed to murder people.
The last stage of gentrification is
hobo murder,
the reverse purge.
Yeah. Bingo. Thank you.
You should make the reverse purge.
It sounds like Mayday,
killing poor people.
Yeah, that'd be awesome. And people, which people are just like cheering the screen. They're watching these movies.
The movie tickets are like four times as expensive as normal.
Did you see that story going around about the people crying in their $1 million condos in San Francisco because there's like a homeless alleyway?
Oh, the best part about I did see it, and the best part about that is it's like luxury condos on like I think it was fucking like Willow and Van Ness, and I'm like, what the fuck, luxury condo? I'm like,
yeah, it's not a nice neighborhood.
Why are they crying?
It's like they're crying because they're like, this is a $1 million condo. Why do we have to deal with all these drug addicts and hobos? And it's
they
like,
weren't
the
crying wasn't from like sympathy,
frustration.
No, yeah, no, no, they were fucking.
It wasn't like, oh, this is so sad that they have to live out there and we live up here. Okay,
yeah.
It's like, no, you're the
idiot. So I don't see what's wrong with that.
It's like, get out of the ghetto, okay? Move to Pack Heights, okay?
Yeah,
do a nice
a, stop.
Go up the fucking hill to Bob Hill, like
yeah.
If you want to be a fucking like rich shithead. I hate and like not deal with homeless people. You can go to Pack Heights.
I would say if you're in the penthouse suite, just start throwing your feces out of in a bucket. Start collecting it all in a bucket for probably like a month, and then just start throwing it out the window under the alley.
So what do you do like Rob Lowe while you're shitting into a bucket?
Very Joker.
You gotta keep your shit. Where do you keep your shit for a month?
The just next bucket, toilet.
Yeah, you just gotta live with it.
You shit in a bucket. Come on, Chris.
Also, I mean, it's like
you never shit in a bucket for a month.
You got the little like green compost bucket thing. Like, just put it in there. That's all you do.
But okay. but without a lid. Think about like composting without a lid.
What do I just keep it on a deck or something?
Keep it right next to your toilet, man, for convenience. Because if you're somebody me, you're pooping at least 10 times a day, and so you're not gonna want to have to run out to the balcony, bring in your shit bucket, poop, and then run it back out. Just leave it in by your toilet.
Okay, all right. I'm picking up what you're putting down. There's some ideas there.
And all you really got to do is like just put a bottle of what's the fucking purple cleaner shit that like all the Mexicans use.
Fabuloso.
Yeah, like just put like open a bottle of that and just put it right next to it, and like that shit, the smell is gonna get like masked over no matter what.
Well, yeah, Adam's doing it right now.
Adam, do you use Fabuloso?
That's how I can do the podcast in here. What do you say?
Dipping as like a dipping sauce for your hidden apples in your bathroom.
Ew. This is so gross, guys. Right.
Well, you're in the bathroom. I'm picturing him like bobbing for the apple in the toilet.
Did y'all already say that?
I'm in the bathroom, but you guys are I'm in the bathroom, but you guys are lowering yourselves to bathroom.
We're in
level.
The gutter, your bro. Level. Our minds are in your level, bro.
I'm only physically. Yes, I'm actually in a bathroom, but I'm saying you guys are hitting.
Adam's neighbors are throwing feces at his apartment, trying to get him out.
Yeah, well, you're. Yeah, yeah
you're he's the trash of the neighborhood.
I'm 5 gallon buckets at a time.
That's
I'm on the corner of Willow and Van Ness, in the gutter right now, actually. Shitting on the goddamn sidewalk so that you know I can up some numbers for Ryan next time he comes into town. You know
what kind of numbers?
Think about Hayden Fieldmore
shit numbers because I got four
shit numbers. He's at four sightings. I want to get him to at least five. So,
dude, I can find five turds.
I can find five turds around my block.
All right.
But can you find actual turds, or is it more like diarrhea? Is it more just like because whatever?
I'm always surprised it's as solid as it is. I honestly think
it's like it looks better than mine. Sometimes
you would think diarrhea would be rare, but it's actually more common in San Francisco. It's actually.
Is it what's the percentage diarrhea versus solid turds?
Oh, 2-1.
No.
2-1.
Probably like 3-4-1. There's a lot of solid turds.
Yeah.
Honestly, like
the three I did were all diarrhea. But the one I saw was
I've actually had this thought before that like one thing that sucks and makes being poor like harder is that you have fucking diarrhea and shit a lot. Because you have
not
to
the ones
eat.
In San Francisco, my man.
Wow.
I don't know if that's like.
Say that again, Adam. Say that again.
You have diarrhea more if you're poor.
I think the one thing that sucks about Adam. Being poor is.
What'd you say?
You can lead a populist revolution in this country.
I mean, it's kind of fucked up. It's
like, George
H.W.
Bush's
about.
Mother.
You can
you sound like the bluest of the blue bloods. I think Adam is secretly rich.
No, it's true. Well, I mean, you know, when you.
That's why Adam is so dumb. This whole time we've been. We can't figure out why Adam is so dumb, and it's because he's secretly rich. And he's just pretending to be a trash poor person.
Yeah.
I'm just doing it for the out of touch alien.
He is a cartoon. He's a cartoon.
I absolutely can validate and verify that he is in fact rich. I have seen the house he grew up in. It's on the water.
Yes.
I mean,
his fucking front yard is the goddamn water. Like,
his parents paid for his first movie right out of college.
No, not really. They helped me a little bit.
Not really.
It's a $2,000. It's a $2,000 movie.
Adam, what? If you're having
that's a lot of
diarrhea, bro.
Don't ask.
Cook different, man.
No, it's true.
Or people have
restaurant options. Your restaurant options are more likely to give you diarrhea. It's true. But my parents, by the way, like, we live in a good house, but we're not rich.
But you have diarrhea constantly.
They pay for your first
The funny thing is that William is the rich kid on the podcast.
What's the diarrhea? William is the secret rich kid.
That's why he's a baby.
Adam, is that why you're recording on a toilet?
I was going to say.
Is that your diarrhea that bad?
Matt
isn't being called out for being a rich kid.
No, grew up rich, I mean.
I did not grow up rich. This is true.
So...
You know where I grew up.
For all the listeners, just for the record,
you know where I grew up. Beautiful Hayton Fillmore, Lower Hayte. Just a young whippersnapper.
Lower Hayte was fucking cutty as shit back in the day.
That's right.
My
family only owned four properties in a small neighborhood in San Francisco. Okay,
that is pretty rich.
Which they lost. Which they all sold before it took off. So.
Yeah,
I was almost
because
that
rich. Shit was like
almost rich, and that's the pain I have to go through.
That sucks.
So what's the moral?
Yeah,
of the story?
I was rich.
Moral of the story is
diarrhea.
Rob Lowe, great actor.
What's Man, the moral you guys are just cowards. That's an interesting point. I think that I've made that nobody's talked about.
What's that? The shit thing.
Yeah, shit thing.
Or people have diarrhea. What is poor in your mind?
Just, you know, like
how much money? Salary?
Oh, I don't know. I'm not really.
What's a poor person?
To be honest.
Yeah, what is a poor person to you, Adam?
Like $30,000. I mean, I fucking was poor until the past couple of years. So it's like I get it, but like if you have kids and shit and you're poor,
you're
damn, that sucks.
Man, like, you're rich now, aren't you?
I mean,
do you live in Laguna Beach or Laguna Hills?
I can live in Laguna Beach.
All right. Next to a cop?
We pay less than we paid in LA, though. What'd you say?
I said, well, yeah, no shit.
No, I know. I just know a cop.
That's the point of Orange County.
Okay, let's do let's finish this fucking thing.
What's the matter?
Wow, now that
things getting too real for you?
I can tell. We can keep talking about it. It's cool.
Dude, what do you think is the moral of the story, Adam?
Hold on.
You can talk do the show instead of just complaining.
I can't.
Dude,
you bring nothing to the
table. Speaking of LA in the early 90s,
bring a lot.
Go on, hold on.
And
Adam,
cultural touchstones in this movie. I just saw that they're doing a reunion reboot of the 92, like of the second season of The Real World, the first LA one.
Oh, cool. Yeah, because they did the first one,
same
right?
Time.
We got the What's cowboy. That?
They did the, yeah, with the first cowboy. Season.
It was the second season. First
good
season
TV.
Of New York.
You know, for TV. Me, though, my favorite Real World season is season 3, San Francisco.
Oh, absolutely.
Puck,
like,
yeah.
Literally.
Puck, yeah.
Pedro.
Yeah. Yep.
Hanging out in the Lower Hayte, going to Armadillo Bar.
Never seen it. Don't.
the building.
Rachel,
the
who becomes like a psych. Rachel, like, and Puck, Rachel. Like, meeting up at the Olive. Or the whatever that stupid Olive restaurant is in North Beach.
Dude, Judd marrying Pam.
Oh, Judd. You know that Judd and Pam still live. Like they live in over by the UCSF hospital.
Oh, that's beautiful.
Yeah. Hey, it's still around. Still
okay,
around.
Adam, go on.
I've been
okay,
trying
Adam.
To hang out with them, but they ignore me every time I like DM them.
Don't worry, dude. Just keep DMing.
I think their
Don't...
kids are like college age now or whatever. I hope they named one of them Pedro.
I hope they named one of them Puck. Didn't Puck die?
Oh, did he? He might have. I think he might have actually.
Anything could happen.
Let me. I'm gonna look up.
What the
hell y'all talking about?
Talk about snot rockets, story. Man. That's where I learned.
If you think,
you put your finger in the peanut butter. You put your finger in the peanut butter.
Everything about that fucking
great character.
God damn.
Adam, tell us the moral of the story.
I wish I have seen it.
Yeah, what is the moral of the story, Adam?
You think it might pay to be bad, but it actually costs you everything.
That's a great
point. Oh, was that the quote on the cover of the VHS?
No, dude, I just made that up.
That's good.
Yeah, thanks, man.
The moral of the story is
that was the point.
Yeah, like I didn't think I was going to say everything at the end, but then I...
What if at the end of the movie, Rob Lowe tearfully told James Spader, like, look, all I wanted was just a little success, a little money, okay? I've had diarrhea my whole life. I just want a solid
Rob Lowe's like, you're poor?
You don't know what it's like being poor.
I eat just garbage food because I'm a poor person. I have a terrible diet. I eat...
I'm not saying across the board. I'm just saying
I just eat refried beans more likely. All day long. And drink purple drink.
I mean, have you heard of food deserts? It's a real thing.
Yeah, it is a real thing. That's not where Rob Lowe lives in this movie.
That's where Adam used to live.
I can promise you that.
I grew up in the food desert, yeah.
No, you didn't, motherfucker. No, I didn't. I'm just kidding. You grew up off the corner of Main Street. There was like a ton of really good restaurants over
fucking
there.
Fucking Main Street?
Main Street, yeah.
Literal fucking Main Street. Like,
where is it?
It's
Tampa?
Some straight up... No, it's in Dunedin.
Very walkable, it's like very, very walkable downtown.
It's why? Like, I would compare it more to like, what's the town that is in Gilmore Girls? Like those like weird, quaint New England, like right, small
I'm
towns.
I'm muting you, Matt, for bringing up Gilmore Girls. Okay? That's, just like... that's the no-go zone, okay?
That show's pretty good.
No, like Matt, like honestly, like William's doing kind of
like
a joke,
but
we
okay?
legally
keep it in the...
No, we legally can't talk about Gilmore Girls. There's like a...
Yeah, they've sent us a cease and desist.
Ever since I dumped.
Because they're like, it's too much, guys.
All right, my bad.
Yeah, no, just, about, no.
Alexis Bledel but... broke her heart. I can't bring up that shit.
When I was a script read, I was a script reader when I first moved to LA and like an unpaid or whatever at the Sony lot. Yeah, and
no way.
And
guy with terrible.
They wouldn't pay you.
and I bumped into Alexis Bledel in the elevator one time.
Did you say?
Mute him.
I saw you put the anyway. Your finger in the peanut butter. Try to bring it back.
I don't know. I haven't seen it, but
yeah, what's your real world, Adam? What's your season?
Vegas? I don't know if I've ever watched the season of The Real World. I'm not a Bay Boy.
Jaws on the floor. Everybody in the world has just they're freaking out over that.
Yeah, I just like that.
What's your favorite reality?
Real World sucks, and so do you.
Oh, calm down, buddy.
That's not true.
Bully this guy. He next thing you know, he's shooting you.
Yeah.
Maybe you confessed all your crimes on camera.
Yeah, I'm a little jokerish, you might say.
Okay, so he didn't die.
Here's the moral of the story, guys. Look, if you're gonna be a grifter, if you're gonna be a psychopath, you're gonna taunt a loser. Get money. Don't do it for free and just sit around and eat popcorn and laugh while you're murdering people. Yeah. And
don't get too caught up in the theatrics.
Yeah,
that was his real downfall.
That's
yeah.
his
eventually,
money, though, you dummy. That's his
eventually
money.
You're gonna get, yeah. you're gonna get caught. It's gonna fall apart. You need to do what Matt did. Take your money. Go from town to town. Put in cryptocurrency. Okay. Mm-hmm. Grow rat yeah. town.
No, no.
That's right.
Matt,
no, do it for the passion. Do it for the love of the craft. If
Matt
you
looks like
if
a guy
you
who
need to
from
murder
prison,
people,
and it's changed his identity. He's got the blonde
classic art versus commerce argument. I feel like.
But
I'm
the only Ryan identity, bad. The only identity change was the rat tail. It's a clip on rat tail.
Clip on my ass, you motherfucker! So this shit's real.
It'd be awesome if it came off.
It came up.
God damn, that'd be amazing.
Or just you can clearly see a giant clip.
Is that such a good ending for the episode?
I don't want to be offensive, but I mean, you look like the Tiger King. You know that, right? Like you've oh gone God. Horseshoe theory to Tiger King.
You got to do.
Yeah, kind of.
You look like maybe it's time to go back to the office.
Tiger King and his origin story.
Tame that beast.
This is the origin story of Tiger King. My friend Eddie like lives down the street from Carol Baskin or whatever, like in Tampa.
Did she do it?
Yeah, did she?
I'm sure. I mean, fuck her. I don't know. I didn't actually watch it. Like,
You're the Tiger Prince, and you didn't even watch the show.
it hits too close.
You don't need to lie. We know you've seen it.
It's like mall Santas. He's not like the real Santa Claus, but he just is like he's like one of those satellite guys.
Tiger King and Dog.
It's like the guy in Portlandia who's just like, "You stole that from me, man." It's like
that's really.
Wait, which one?
That's a good sketch.
I never saw that sketch.
Yeah, I don't know which one you're talking about.
Let's cut that off on the air.
What's that?
Let's do what?
Have a contest. What's that? You can win Matt's.
Gross.
Matt's rat tail.
Gross.
Oh God, no.
Gross.
Yeah, let's send it to you in the mail and a nice.
You gotta braid it though first, so then you know it'll.
Well, last time,
yeah.
Last time I had a rat tail like this was back like, I mean, shit. It was probably like 2000. It was like mid 2000s, but nice. I was like, nice. I started to dread it, and then I'm like, you know what?
Oh god,
no, I'm going too far.
Yeah.
And then I let me and
that's a good call, man.
Adam's friend Austin cut it off, and it was like his happiest like moment.
When you cut it off, did you say Elvis has left the building?
No. I think I just went in the bathroom and cried, and then like you know.
Sorry, Bear.
Decided to get a therapist from that point on because I was just like, this was too traumatic for me.
Rat Tail does kind of act like a therapist.
It's kind of like your venom. I can chew on it, so it's like it allows me to, you know,
for real.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. I mean, I really can chew on it.
So I agree.
He looks like a character in Dune.
Yeah,
it allows him to breathe the shitty San Francisco air as he wanders up and down the hills of the Tenderloin.
I'm gonna try to see that tomorrow, and
it's boring. I'm
gonna see that in the movie theater tomorrow.
Good for you, Adam.
What movie theater are you gonna go to, Adam?
Yeah, tell us.
Shitty Regal that's in Orange County.
Hmm. Cool.
Is that because you live in Laguna Hills?
I'm just gonna go watch it with a bunch of cops.
You and the cops.
And I'll be like, I'm with my friends.
Like a gay bar?
Here's the weird, like a bunch of cops.
Yeah. They're all in uniform.
Speaking of cops, they're too tight, little too tight uniforms.
There's a great gay bar in downtown LA called The Precinct.
Oh, that's cool, end scene,
by the way, with the cops like rolling up, like the two on the beach in their like weird Bronco like cop trucks, and then the other two like on the like whatever the PCH, you know, like in the normal cars or whatever. I thought that was like a fucking sick ass scene. And then the way that they kind of like aerial view over it, like as he kind of comes to his finalization of like, well, I guess it's over for me. Except for one thing that was like weird. Speaking of moral of the story of that though, didn't he kind of like get what he wanted out of life?
Ironically, like, yes. At all, he
right?
did.
Like, and he's gonna get away with it. Like. From what it sounds like,
I don't think he'll get away with it.
Yeah, like, no.
I was really hoping that, and if I would have wrote this movie, this is how I would have wrote it. That final scene where he's walking up to the cops in his trench coat, and yeah, he didn't even have his hands up, and he's just walking up. You can tell this was made. You can tell this was made before school shootings, yeah. But if all the cops like out of nowhere just tased him, they just blasted him and then they just shot him after that. Like he's being tased so hard that he can't fall down because he's just like shocked up.
And then they're not really sure which one's which because they see the brother coming up right behind and he looks like you know, an underwater version of them. And they're like kill them both.
Well, that's tased. The cops run because they think his brother is like already his ghost. They're like, this is clearly what this guy is going to look like after we tase him so hard.
It's a ghost. Get out of here. Yeah, that'd be awesome. That's a much better version of the ad nature.
Yeah.
Damn. Right. You should be a screenwriter. I keep telling you.
I'm trying.
Your instincts are spot on.
So what's everyone's ratings? Let's rate this shit. Adam, you go first because you're the king of ratings. You're the decisive
thank
one.
Thank you. That's very sweet of you.
You don't say a bunch of bullshit. Just give your rating.
Yeah. Why don't start with and I.
Three and a half.
He copied me, of course.
No, I got. I did not copy. He copied. I came up with a rating. Did
is not it out look of at five? Williams.
Yeah, it's Williams out of five.
Thing on Letterboxd.
He copies me every time.
He just William always.
Also.
Yeah, I gave it 3.5. I honestly wasn't sure between 3 and 3.5, but I'm leaning 3.5. Okay.
Yeah, I'm like a. I'm like it. A 2.753 area.
Here's the thing.
That's fair too.
I'll go into my rating because I'm interesting. So.
Yeah.
I thought. I was thinking like.
No, it's
that is an,
no,
that is an interesting perspective.
It's Saturday night. I got to rewatch this fucking movie. This is, you know, I've already seen it, but it just went by so fast. It just went down so easily. This movie is a smooth drink. You know, it's like a nice cold shot of vodka.
This is pretty interesting what you're saying, William.
I agree with William. I loved this movie. I ended up, I'm going to give it a 4.75. It made me.
Boom.
Whoa.
Yearn for more movies.
Love your passion.
Well, just well fucking written. Like, and just enjoyable.
Slick.
And I loved it. It was slick. It was great. I fucking loved this film. I want more. I wish more films existed like this today that, you know,
more
so
thrillers.
Films, yeah.
Drop Dead Fred.
So many films
is
rely
one.
On bullshit.
Right?
This film couldn't rely on any bullshit. It just had to be well written to be good. And I think they knocked it out of the park.
Good job, Stathis. That was good.
I think it's a 4 because I think
nice.
I really liked it because I think more, at least for me, like having not even seen it before, which I was kind of surprised that I hadn't because I thought I did, but I hadn't. And I was just like, but the thing that like I thought was really good because it's obviously like it's pretty like tightly written and pretty cool in that regard. But it's also, I just think like one of the better just like visually like neo-noir LA movies of that era kind of thing. Yeah. And it's just like
shot this DP like, ended up becoming Paul Thomas Anderson's DP, shot Boogie Nights, Magnolia.
Oh, wow. Oh really?
There Will Be Blood. Won an Oscar later
that,
on.
That makes a lot of sense.
He cut his teeth on these like shitty exploitation movies or like, you know, genre
it
films.
Good,
not
yeah.
like art films. So like
yeah,
beautiful
yeah, no,
lighting,
no, no, no.
beautiful outdoor night scenes, great lighting with like Venetian blinds.
It's a good
great color
capsule.
Palette, very subdued.
Yes. Yes.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
It's a good time capsule.
I particularly yuppie. Liked that the opening scene was a fade in from black to
topless
titties. Yep.
Yeah. Oh yeah.
With
yeah.
the title on top.
Always a
that's when you know.
Yeah, I didn't care for that
anymore.
Part. I didn't care for that part.
Sidney Lumet.
What I would have done if I was writing this, I would have done instead of the title, I would have had like more titties.
Yeah.
I mean,
in
Sidney
Lumet's
well.
Book
yeah.
about filmmaking, he talks about how important the first shot
titties
and
are.
The last shot of a movie are they like the bookend shots or whatever
start with
Sidney
titties
Lumet
and with titties
often said that
throw a couple asses
I think that's why I think
at least
I think
three
it cool
at least three
if,
dicks.
If the bullet that shot Rob Lowe opened his shirt and his and he had a beautiful pair of tits and then he
I
fell
it like hits the button and his shirt and the blouse just pops open
and then James Spader's like what and then Rob Lowe just falls backward and dies and he's like wait a minute.
It's the greatest tits I've ever seen.
It's like I thought his driving motivation
weeping.
Was his weird, like nihilistic, like hatred of people's like hypocrisy. But it turns out that he was just gender dysphoric and
yeah,
like,
yeah. Wow, I've learned a valuable
and, like, didn't
lesson
have,
today.
You know, and this was like pre-internet days, so he didn't really know like how to navigate that because he had no like access to that community, and like it, that was really what it was. And then James Spader's like, shit, I probably shouldn't have shot the trans girl.
I'll tell you what, you know, kids
everybody
today
starts
in San Francisco,
booing.
Yeah.
And that's
that
why
problem,
he
okay.
goes and he tells the cops everything. He goes, I deserve
it. It's also why the cops didn't
I deserve, yeah.
Especially then, because they're like, oh,
cancel me.
You're good.
Cancel me.
Cancel me.
Oh.
Good stuff, guys.
Good stuff. That is always the fucking filler. Good stuff.
Oh, I remember LOL at because like remember how in Youngblood you see Rob Lowe's ass, and it's like a weird ass.
Yes, I can't forget.
He's a young guy. It's a nice tight ass.
Every time I close my eyes,
he's kind of skinny. I think he's a little skinny.
He's a young guy.
He's got a nice little on my skinny tush.
But it's I laughed when I saw. It's just like Rob Lowe's constantly showing his kind of skinny ass. In 80s movies,
you were LOLing at that.
I LOL.
You're like, did you look at that ass and you're like, oh, you can tell that ain't a poor ass. You can tell diarrhea don't come out of that ass. This guy got money.
Those are full fucking thick turds.
That's an ass that thick turds snake out of.
I mean,
hey, Adam, how long have you had this diarrhea theory that you've been doing?
Diarrhea theory. That's the name of a
couple,
band, right?
Couple
there.
Years.
That's a couple, name only of a couple years. Punk band.
An emo band.
I'm gonna name the emo band that I start in honor of you. That I'm gonna jokingly pretend to have you join. Diarrhea theory.
But you're not. But you're actually not a
diarrhea theory.
Yeah.
Diarrhea theory. Mean,
I'd be curious to see the statistics.
Oh, there's like flies and bugs in your bathroom. It's like a big bug blew up around Adam's ass and like
I just saw that too.
I just saw it flying in front too, and I was like, I wonder if I can see that.
You know, Adam, if you really wanted to find out if this theory was true, this could be your opportunity to go back to grad school and study it. Like you could get a sociology PhD.
Yeah, it could be my thesis.
Something.
Yeah.
People would just go like, no, that's not that's just racism, Adam.
No, it's not. It has nothing to do with race.
That's just racism.
All of a sudden,
they would find a reason. They would find a reason.
He starts referencing mostly phrenology, fucking like textbooks and stuff.
He becomes like a right wing hero. They're like, no, let him speak. It's like,
no, that's not how it would go down.
Adam goes on the Joe Rogan podcast. He's like, all right, tell us about this theory, man. Like,
I think it would go the other way and be like
just bugs and
like
shit flying around like him on the Joe Rogan podcast.
No, the left.
You just bring your bucket of shit to Joe Rogan's podcast. You're like, well, if you compare the two,
having constant diarrhea. Oh, you're just showing him your
by
bank.
Having diarrhea.
You just show people your bank account, and then while you're shitting, while you're having diarrhea into a bucket, and you're like, here's my proof.
And then you go,
why
then
else
you're like negative.
Yeah,
you're like,
while you're
notice.
On the Joe Rogan experience, you're like, hey, why don't you shit into this bucket and I'll show you how firm it is, and I'm gonna compare it to your bank account versus my shit in my bank account.
He goes, Joe, I'm not quite in the red, but I'm almost there. I'm a few dollars away from being in the red. Add $1 million to my bank account and watch, and you're just constantly like shitting diarrhea, liquid diarrhea.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And as the money transfers, your diarrhea stream just solidifies and turns into like a healthy turd that pops out.
Yeah, it starts
because you got money in your bank account, and that's
like
your
T-1000.
It's like a Christmas magic sort of thing.
Gross! It's a T-1000.
Exactly.
Turd.
Exactly.
Oh fucking a! Hey.
God, man.
Turd 1000, bro.
Turd
1000.
Oh.
That should be the name of this podcast.
I'm gonna literally.
I guarantee
send
you,
Joe
we
Rogan
would have more followers.
And see if he'll bring Adam on.
Adam, send him a DM about your BMs, bro.
Third 1000. They're opening up for diarrhea theory, right?
Yeah.
Send him a BM.